Howdy. Welcome back to a Chem Informatic lecture. And in this lecture, we'll be talking about how to set up your Jupyter Notebook structure and then other tricks and hacks that you can kind of do with your Jupyter Notebook to make your workflow more clean. And then you can kind of see what my file structure is and see how I can organize a lot of pages in my notebook at scale and then how I kind of use it in a more professional setting. So to start off, I'm going to show you how to first run the Jupyter Notebook and then how to, if you want to be working remotely and you want to run the Jupyter Notebook on your workstation, but have the access to the UI of the Jupyter Notebook on your local machine. And so that concept is called port forwarding. And so if we get started into this lecture, on the left-hand side of the screen here, you'll see the workstation that I have somewhere that's in the cloud. And on the right-hand side is my local machine. So inside my cloud computer, first I'm gonna call the Python environment that I have installed. I'm gonna first do dash m and then Jupyter, which is the Jupyter package. Then I'm going to call the notebook package. There's a certain amount of flags that we'd like to pass in to kind of make it easier for authentication and the port forwarding to come back into our local machine. So one of the things I do is that we don't actually need to run the UI on the workstation, and that can be pretty heavy on terms of the RAM and maybe even the CPU. So like things can kind of get mucky there. So I like to run the Jupyter Notebook headless. So you pass in the flag, no browser. The next thing I like to do is specify the port. Traditionally, I stick to 8889. The last thing that I want to do is the authentication. So when you have to usually log into Jupyter Notebook, they require like a token password. Now I'm just running this by myself, so I only have my own notebook to kind of take care of. So I like to kind of tell the authentication token that there is no token, and so that you should just allow me in. That's not the traditional norm, but you can kind of specify your token flag here at the startup. And so I'll kind of show you that flag, even though it's not obvious in the documentation. So it's notebook app dot token, and then you pass in the empty string. So now let's run that notebook. And then you can kind of see here, all authentication is disabled, meaning that like I can now access that server. And you can see here that the server is now running on 8889. Oh. I would like that server, what's running there, to be on my local machine, on my Mac computer. So you can do this for anything, but maybe there's a different command for Windows, I don't know. So for a Linux Mac computer, this will hold. So to do the port forwarding, we're going to write the SSH command, and we're going to do dash n, meaning we're not going to be doing any remote execution commands on the cloud computer. We're only doing this for port forwarding. So I think there's some restrictions within their code that they kind of limit when you just say port forwarding. We're going to run it in the background, and then we need to specify the address. So localhost, which is our local machine, and then we can say 8886, so that's just what the default is. And then we say what the port running on the cloud computer, so localhost 8889, and then the address of that computer. So if I do this, you'll see that the command is run, and then now something should be running on my local computer. So if we go there and we type in localhost 8886, you'll see my Jupyter Notebook. So one thing that I do is that I have a lot of data analysis. So as I'm processing a lot of chemicals, I have a lot of different files and workflows that I try to manage. And as I'm kind of processing data. So what I've done is kind of model after a lab notebook. And so you can kind of see here, I specify each file name with the number and then what a description of that workflow. And so it kind of helps me organize over time, like a mass amount of different types of workflows. And so that's kind of what I do. So let's shut down that server and then let's look at something a little bit different. In Jupyter Notebooks, you'll see that it took some time for the code to actually start up and get running. And what's going on here is that it's actually running a lot of other code under the hood to kind of get this thing up and going. Jupyter Notebook, when it was first released, it actually stems off of IPython. So IPython was first before Jupyter Notebook. And so Jupyter Notebook actually calls IPython under the hood. And so if you go into tilde/.ipython, you'll arrive at this directory where you'll see extensions, NB extensions, and profile default. So what I like to do for my workflows is I like to go into profile default and then go into the startup directory. In here, I have certain Python files. And if you look at the README that's provided with your IPython, it states in here, .py and .ipy files in this directory will be run prior to any code or file specified via the exec lines. Meaning that, let's say that you wanted to import like NumPy, you could write your import here and then rather have it go like import NumPy on every single lab notebook script, it'll already do it when you first start the server. So if you can see here, I have this file 001 handle imports. And in here, you can kind of see all the imports I do for my different workflows. And I don't want to type this in on every workflow. And so like, sure, it's a little bit memory heavy. So when you run your Jupyter Notebook, maybe not necessarily you want to use all these packages. But in a professional environment where you're doing this work every day, it's actually a very useful tool to keep your code clean and organized. Okay, so that is the lecture for today. It's a very quick one on Jupyter Notebook architecture and then just kind of setting it up and kind of port forwarding back to your local machine. I hope that this will be useful in the next lecture when we start analyzing a bigger chemical data set and using the Jupyter Notebook to start plotting data and then start inferring certain things from it. Please like and subscribe the video, and I will see you guys in the next one.